Alright, what is up guys? In this video I'm going to be talking about what would happen in Season 3 of Seraph of the End. Now, I did have a poll issued out weeks ago, basically saying what video did you want to come back on the channel, and you guys asked for Seraph of the End Season 3, everything you basically should know. So, in this video I'll be going over just that. Now, this video is not an update video about the status of Season 3. If that's what you came here for, then just go watch this video, but in this video, I'm going to be going over the source material, that being the manga, and now that the anime ended on chapter 41 of the manga, and season 1 and 2 basically go over 20 chapters of the manga each, meaning season 3 would probably have 12 episodes and would also consist of 20-ish chapters, give or take, that being 42 through 62. So don't forget to like the video, but let's begin. Let's begin with chapter 42. It begins in Moscow, Russia, where we see some dancers frantically dancing, and we meet the second progenitor, Urgellus. What, enjoying yet another performance, Lord Urgellus? Please enlighten me. What is so interesting about watching livestock sing and dance? Does the blood of those that sing well taste better or something? Enters the third progenitor, Lest Carr. State your business, Lest. You were given Germany to rule. Return to your post. But I have nothing to do in Germany. After all, my control over the area is absolute, and my governance is perfect. Quite unlike Cruel Tempest in Japan, I might add. In fact, I hear there was an incident in her district. Has this matter been brought to your attention yet, Lord Jellius? Lord Jellius, there has been a livestock uprising in Japan. The Seraph of the End. The Seraph of the End experiment. What has Cruel Tempest been doing? Oh, I'm sure something like that was far too much for her. Though if I were to be in control of Japan, then none of this. Silence, Lest. Continue. We've received an urgent transmission from Japan requesting an emergency session of the Progenitor Council. They wish to convey immediately an emergency. Then we go inside of St. Basil's Cathedral. Shall we connect the transmission to Kyoto? Yes, do it. Here we see Cruel tied up and look a little beaten as well. What is this? What's happening in Japan? Then we see Firid about to give his transmission call. Testing, testing. Is this thing on? Can you see me? Firid Bothery. My, my. If it isn't the second progenitor, Urgellus. Lords and ladies of the Progenitor Council, I humbly apologize for the most abrupt of summons. Then we see one of the progenitors getting very angry. What? You're not even a member of the council and you dare to call for it to be conveyed? Yes. I'm afraid we have a dire emergency on our hands. How dare you! You, a mere seventh progenitor! Silence, Nyx. Firid is the next highest ranking vampire in Japan, after Cruel Tempest. Given her state, she certainly couldn't make the summon. Think before you speak. Then they get to the explanation. Well, you see, we actually have a surprisingly and highly inconvenient issue on our hands at the moment. And then we see the 13th progenitor in the background. I haven't seen Ferret in such a good mood in ages. Maybe, but I'd really rather not get killed in one of his pranks, nor I. We cut back to the second progenitor, Urid. Enough of the theatrics. Make your point. And then Ferret gets to his point. The third progenitor, Cruel Tempest herself, was in league with the humans and their Seraph of the End experiment. And everyone's face is in disbelief. Not only that, the experiment succeeded. The humans now have a fully weaponized Seraph of the End. Both myself and my close ally, the 13th progenitor Crowley, Esford, risked our lives to apprehend the traitor Cruel Tempest. Well, I guess I'm involved now. Aw, jeez. But the power the humans have acquired is great. We vampires here in Japan have no way to counter it. And then they cut to the entrance of their palace. Then we cut to outside where we see Gruen and Kirito basically destroying their palace. It's the humans. The humans are attacking the city. Fall back. Fall back. They'll kill us all. Currently, the vampire presence in Japan, including our capital, is in danger of being wiped out. Believable. That can't be. Lord Ferret, the humans have reached the palace. Please take shelter immediately. You can see our predicament. I'm sure my lords and ladies of the Progenitor Council wish to come here to eradicate these rebels personally. But First, I would beg permission to withdraw our presence from Japan, temporarily. And if I may, I'd like to deliver the traitor of Cruel Tempest to you directly, Japan. And then we cut to another part of Japan. We see you struggling.
Let me go! Unchain me right now!
He's basically chained up right now and he's losing control.
I'll kill you. I'll kill all of you.
You, please.
Okay, I'm done reading this out to you. I'm gonna give you a summary of what happens in the anime for the rest of the chapters. Now, if you enjoyed me reading this to you, then, I don't know, tell me other series you would like me to read to you, then maybe I'll bring this back. So, chapter 43. So, Yu's demon has been taking over his body longer than normal. Mika is not yet ready to trust the humans and is getting into it with Shinoa, but eventually comes around to it and starts drinking their blood to stay nourished, and they come to the conclusion to go after Cruel Tempest. Chapter 44. Spirit proves he is on demon time, reiterating that he killed Yu and Mika's family for fun. He also killed all 13 progenitors' friends as well, that being Crowley. Crowley stops them from running away as well. Chapter 45. Furid plays with them and shows them the decapitated head of their family member. Chapter 46. Furid makes his deal with Yu, drinking his blood, tells the group that he was a friend of Gurren since his high school days, and tells them that the Seraph of the End project brings people back to life. Chapter 47. It starts out with Kuroto and Gurren talking about overthrowing the Hiragi family. The gang gets on the bus with Furid. Gurren goes to Shinoa and explains why he's been acting so strange. Chapter 48. The group talks about whether or not to believe Furid. Chapter 49. Cruel and Sayato talk about some of the family history of vampires and explain that Yu's demon sword was once the first progenitor's kid who was turned into a demon. And also, Furid brought them to the entirety of the vampire army. Chapter 50. Furid meets up with the second and third progenitor vampire and they go to confront Stafford, and the humans are hostages. Chapter 51. Yoichi wants to kill the Lactus vampire because he killed his sister. Furid and Cruel receive exposure torture, which is basically them burning alive. Chapter 52. Group goes into Farid's mansion where they are told that if they want to rescue Farid and Cruel, they have to get stronger, and basically as strong as the fifth progenitor to do so. Chapter 53. Mika and the group argue about how long a vampire can keep their humanity. Crowley goes into detail about his human life, that being a crusader in the Holy War many years ago. Chapter 54 and 55, because they're basically the same thing. Gurren goes to Farid's mansion, then Shinoa fights Gurren. Apparently back in high school, Maharu had a lover and a fiance. The lover being Gurren and the fiance being Shinoa, and they basically fight over again while her ghost is looking at them. It's kind of wild. Chapter 56 and 57. The Hiragi War comes to an end, and this is when Kuroto kills his father, but this doesn't end because he then has to meet the first vampire who has been possessing his father all this time, Shigama Doji. Chapter 58, 59, and 60. Gurren tells the group that his motives are to bring back humanity, and he tells them how to be the fifth progenitor. Chapter 61 and 62. So this is where there's like a flashback of Yu in the cell talking to Maharu. So there's basically a flashback of Yu talking to Maharu when he was a child, and how he was a test subject before going into the orphanage, saying that he was also a demon spawn as well, hinting about some other stuff later on. Now that's everything that would have been covered in season 3 of Seraph of the End. Now, if they didn't decide to end on this note in chapter 62, then they probably would end it off in chapter 68. The reason why I say that is because that's a better ending for kind of explaining the angels and the trumpet, essentially. But they would also have to kind of mention the more puberty elements into it, such as the whole love aspect of the characters. And that might be a little bit tougher to do with given 12 episodes, so they probably should just end on chapter 62. In all honesty, Seraph the End has a lot more into it than you might expect. I would assume that they would probably have, like I said, maybe 6 seasons worth of content, and I'm not even joking when I say that. There's a lot of content still left that has not yet been talked about in the anime. Now, if you like this video, do make sure to go and check out this next video, because I feel like you'll like it. So just click on it. But yeah, click on the video. What are you doing? Stop playing.